Mortgage on time. Visit 866-SHIPBAGS.com. Dave Strader, Andy Brickley, Billy Jaffe, glad you're with us here on Versus. Game three of the series is underway as the two top lines going head-to-head. Andy McDonald with Solani and Kunitz against the Sedin twins and Taylor Pyatt. And here is Scott Niedermeyer for the duck side of his own net, starting it back the other way. Good work by Pyatt against Andy McDonald. Each team has made a lineup change from the previous game that we'll tell you about in just a moment. Here's Solani sending it across on the far side. Beauchemin with the most ice time of any skater in that game, too. Hands it off for Solani. Gets it to the front of the net for Kunitz. He's checked on the play by Brent Sopel. As the Ducks try to get something going in the offensive zone, it's taken away. And the Canucks wearing that third jersey that brought them luck in Game 7. And the victory here against the Dallas Stars, it was the only time they wore these third jerseys in that series. Although they did, Andy, wear them 15 times during the year, all on home ice. They won 10 and lost 5, so why not?
And on top of that, the Vancouver Canucks should feel pretty good about themselves, given the way that they won Game 2. It was a battle. They win it in double overtime. They paid a price due to all their injuries. They got contributions from their entire lineup. Now they're back at home.
Here is Cowan, the overtime hero of Game 2. Takes a hit in the neutral zone there from Pronger. And now Rob Niedermeyer starts it back the other way. Travis Moan, who had the only goal for the Ducks in that Game 2 loss, takes a hit. Crowd loves that, and it comes to Marcus Naslund. Hands it off now for Morrison. Morrison will send it in wide of Shiger. Big carom off the board. Picked up on a shot. Shiger, the save and the rebound. Set to the boards. And here is Salo. One of the lineup changes we talked about, Sammy Salo. He took the warm-up skate. We were told it's a game-time decision. Apparently, the decision affirmative.
Yeah, keep a close eye on him, how his movement is, how fluid he is. He's really going to have to manage the way he plays. But good for the Canucks to have him back in the lineup.
Gallo has not played yet in this series, so it's a big addition for the Canucks to get him back now. Jaguar behind the net, hands it off. John O'Donnell failed to get it by Salo. Smolinski to the net. That may have been deflected. Bullets with a chance. Couldn't get much on it. Now Trevor Linden, who set up the overtime winner in Game 2, doing some forechecking. Salo will hold this center and get tipped into the front of the net. It's a free ball! Oh, and Shiger somehow able to stop both of those attempts by the Vancouver Canucks, who have had the best of the play here early.
And Jagir's reaction was, did I get it with my glove? Well, it was under his pad when it finally came to rest before the goal line. A number of quality scoring chances for Vancouver. Right in the early minutes of this first period, shots getting through, nobody in front of the net. It was Pronger who wrapped the puck out around the boards. Nobody there to field it except for Sammy Salo. And now two players rotating back to the front of the net. Jan Boulos with that backhand opportunity, but Shiger keeping this a scoreless game. Sammy Salo back in the lineup, already making a difference, getting shots through at that right point directly to the goal and forcing Shiger to make stops.
Josh Green on the draw here against Getzlaff. It's controlled by the Ducks. Huskins are out of the far side, and there is Brad May, the other lineup change that was made by these two teams. So Salo is in, and the puck is frozen here at the side of the net by Shiger. And Brad May is in as well, and the start of a little scrum here. May started to come in, but then he backs up. There he is, wearing number 24.
Well, you always look for guys to make a difference when they get an opportunity to get back into the lineup. You have to play within the rules. You got to be disciplined, but you want to play physical. You want to bring that energy. Anaheim felt that they did not play as physical as they would have liked in Game 2. That's an area they want to improve on tonight. Brad May certainly brings that element to the lineup.
Served a three-game suspension for an incident that took place in the first round against the Minnesota Wild that we'll talk a little bit more about as this faceoff comes right back to Shiger, and he will cover it there.
J.S. Shiger, we talked about him going into that overtime, Dave, where he had an unblemished record, had been 8-0 in the postseason in extra time. Well, he still has an impressive 8-1 record, but he did get beat on a bad angle goal by Jeff Cowan.
See what he's done the last five times that he's come here to Vancouver. Shiger has terrific career postseason numbers. Salo with a shot, ricochets and goes just wide of Shiger, and it's picked up on the near board. Big hit on Rob Niedermeyer as it came to center ice, and the puck dumped back in by Edler, number 23, one of the youngsters playing on defense because of the injuries to Bieksa, as this puck rolls in, and also Fitzpatrick is not in the lineup. Huskins stands up just inside the blue line, checked on the play, gets to it, and it's out to center ice.
Crowd was looking for a call, Dave, on Scott Niedermeyer away from the play, and the referee gave a safe signal to the crowd.
Centering pass all alone in front. Penner scores! On the forecheck, the Ducks able to take advantage. Luongo well out of the net, and Dustin Penner makes it 1-0.
And this is the line Anaheim was looking for to be a difference tonight. Did not have a strong game in game two. They have tremendous size, all three very good skaters and good offensive instincts. Get the puck in, get physical, use your legs. You cannot be physical unless you're skating. Force Luongo to handle the puck. A nice read by Corey Perry. He's done that a number of times in this series. He has seen where Luongo is wants to go with the puck, steps into the passing lane. That time it was a wraparound on the forehand side by Luongo. Perry the steal. He finds Dustin Penner in front of the net. Penner, Dave, I thought had trouble handling the puck in game two for such a good player. Handled it right there and gave Anaheim the lead.
Well, speaking of trouble handling the puck, that is not a strength of Roberto Luongo, and I believe the Ducks would want Roberto to handle the puck as often as possible. It hurt Roberto on a goal in that Dallas series in the first round, and right there he wasn't able to get it by Corey Perry, who set up Penner, as you saw, for his fifth career playoff goal. And on their first shot, the Ducks have taken a 1-0 lead. Perry the only assist. Now taken on the near board by Daniel Sedin, plays it ahead. It was behind Pyatt. He'll chase it down now, but Sean O'Donnell gets there for the Ducks, plays it up the left wing side. Paulson couldn't get a stick on it. And Vancouver's Willie Mitchell now. Tries to feed it on the right wing side, intercepted. Andy McDonald flips it right back in wide of the Vancouver goal. We're just about 4 minutes in, and this place hasn't been quiet until that goal by Dustin Penner. Now a loose puck in the neutral zone. Oshiman falls down in front of his own bench, but now it's picked up by Solani. What did he have chances in game two? Avoids a near collision with the referee. Now Solani back to the line. Scott Niedermeyer hands it off here now, and the pass by McDonald went between Oshiman and Niedermeyer. That allows Vancouver to make a change here now as the Ducks regroup center ice. Solani tips it in.
McDonald was looking for Boschman, but the minute Niedermeyer started to make an offensive move, Boschman held his ground, and that's why that play didn't connect.
Here's a steal. Scott Niedermeyer with a shot. That's blocked up over the glass and out of play. There's been a lot of talk about how much traffic Roberto Luongo's had to deal with in the first two games of the series.
Well, when you go up against certain goaltenders, there are certain strategies you try to employ. One of them is to get traffic in front of a world-class goaltender like Roberto Luongo, and if you do that, there will be some contact. You try to stay within the rules of the game, not draw any goaltender interference calls at the wrong times to hurt momentum, but certainly attack the net at every opportunity. We've seen bad angle shots. We've seen the fact, too, and we just saw it on the first goal of the game, where you don't worry about your dump-ins to keep the puck away from Luongo. They have no problem with him handling it. And a number of times, if you have that first man put pressure, the second man can take away the wrap around the board.
There is Alain Vigneault, and he, along with Roberto, talking about the amount of contact with the Canuck goaltender. But that is Anaheim's game, and Willie Mitchell told us between games one and two that Roberto, to a certain extent, is just going to have to deal with it. Because defensemen can't do in today's game what you could do 5-10 years ago in terms of physically moving guys out of that area.
Right, they teach fronting the players now. They let the player get in behind you, between you and your goaltender, and you try to block a lot of shots and react to block shots. Not the way the game was played a decade ago, and that has created more contact with goaltenders.
Long pass here, deflected by Daniel Sedin, recovered though by Boschman, hands it off up the middle, and here comes Paulson on the attack. Rob Niedermeyer right side, tries to get a puck through. Hansen got a stick on it for Vancouver. Now it is scooped along and recovered here by Josh Green. Travis Moen in on the forecheck. Dustin Penner's goal, his first of this series and his second of the playoffs this year, as the puck over the glass and out of play. Penner's other goal came in game one against the Minnesota Wild and was the game winner for Randy Carlyle's club.
And Randy Carlyle talked about the importance of a good start here in game three in Vancouver. Vancouver certainly wanted to use the home crowd as a seventh player, certainly a sixth or seventh player on the ice for their team, and feed off the emotions of how they won game two.
Carlisle has that fourth line out here now with Thornton May and Ryan Shannon. His fourth line in that double overtime game did not play much at all. And Hansen trying to get around his man. Now it comes to the side. A shot here, just missed on the short side. Right in by Edler. Now Burrows with Josh Green. Over the front of the net. Hansen was there as well, but the puck recovered by the Ducks. And this is Sean Thornton starting it back the other way. Brad May getting in on the forecheck. Shallow ties him up. Now it comes all the way out to the blue line, and the Ducks were unable to hold it in. Now Pronger getting booed every time he touches the puck. On Bulas, nice play in the neutral zone. Smolinski and Bulas could be a two-on-one. The shot save, rebound, chance. Stopped by Jaguar as well. One goal in the game already, and it came from Dustin Penner. It was the first shot against Roberto Luongo, and it made it 1-0. You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus.
Welcome back to Vancouver, British Columbia. 1-0 the score. Ducks over the Canucks. A good energetic start. Nobody's more happy to be on the ice than Brad May. You guys touched on it earlier. Suspended for 3 games for this incident against the Minnesota Wild in Game 4 when he punched Kent Johnson in the face, knocked him down, and he was suspended for 3 games. Now, he respects the NHL's decision to suspend him. He says that, "I know I did something wrong. I shouldn't have done that, a little over aggressive, but I was just competing for my team, trying to do the best, trying to do what it takes to get this team to the Stanley Cup." He even called Johnsson a few days after the incident to make sure that he was all right, and he called Johnsson the perfect gentleman in taking my call. Back upstairs.
All right, he is back in the lineup indeed after the 3-game suspension, as this play is offside at the Anaheim line. And I was in Anaheim prior to Game 5 of that series against Minnesota when Brad May was talking to the media, and he did seem very contrite. He said, "Look, when I turned around, I didn't know who it was. It was just the first guy coming into a scrum that was already happening."
That's right. When a scrum is going on, or something larger than a scrum, that is a natural reaction, whether you're a tough guy or a guy that really plays a gentlemanly game. But Dave, we talked at the top of this broadcast about the importance of players like a Jeff Cowan. Cowan plays with that type of grit, determination in those ugly areas, the dirty areas that it requires to play, particularly in the postseason. Brad May's just the same way.
Now it's played off the boards by Kunitz, not out of the zone. Covered now by Boschman, hands it off for Scott Niedermayer. Long stretch pass goes by everybody. And who's going to touch this puck first? Krajicek got there just ahead of Kunitz. And again, a collision with Luongo. And that's going to draw a crowd.
Well, cooler heads will prevail, and that's the right thing, because this is one of those plays where, you know, you make the argument for the automatic icing. I know it's had a lot of discussion, a lot of talk about it, but Kunitz is trying to get to this puck before Krajicek can get there. Luongo just has to kind of back off that post, but he can't back too far, because if Kunitz gets to it first, he's going to get a shot on goal. And the minute you lose the strength battle, yeah, you go to the ice, you're going to make contact with the goaltender. Incidental.
Andy, you played in college hockey where they have the automatic icing. You played in the NHL where they don't. Any quick thought on whether they should go to automatic
icing?
Well,
I'm a proponent of the way it is. I feel you have to earn the icing call. You need to get back. I do not like the automatic icing.
All right. Face off to the right of Jaguar now. Carlson and Henrik Sedin. It's controlled by Daniel Sedin now for Henrik, and a penalty coming. It's going to go against Anaheim, and the Sedin that helps to draw this. Delayed penalty, and Luongo will get to the bench for the extra attacker. Here's a shot through traffic, blocked and cleared by Paulson, and we're going to get the call here that will give Vancouver the first power play opportunity of this game.
And it's going to be Scott Niedermayer that's going to go right off the faceoff. This puck's going to go down below the goal line. The Sedins, who have had a good start to this hockey game with their puck possession in the offensive zone, is going to draw this call.
27, minor penalty, hooking.
Right off the draw, puck possession down along the goal line. Body position, watch the stick work. Scott Niedermayer to the midsection, parallel to the ice. He'll go to the box.
A lot of talk about this Vancouver power play. Anemic to say the least. 3 for 50, that is 6% in the playoffs. 0 for 12 in this series. And a clear here by Pronger, but here's an opportunity for your power play. No matter how bad the numbers are, if they can get one here, tie the game, get the crowd back into it.
Yeah, look to simplify. I know that's what everybody talks about when the numbers aren't there and the production's not there. You got to simplify, and it's move the puck quick, get shots on goal, and it starts from out top, and then try to work some low play.
Wyatt moves it along. Now Smolinski to the line. Brendan Morrison, rink wide. Here is Sopel. Now it comes back to Morrison. Through traffic, just wide. Big rebound, cleared though by Sean O'Donnell, and he placed it perfectly down the ice. 8 minutes gone by here in the first period, Game 3. Ducks and the Canucks are even in the series. Anaheim with a 1-0 lead in this game three. Morrison with a good keep-in, but it's knocked away by Rob Niedermeyer. And Boschman came out aggressively. He was trying to get to that loose puck. Now Smolinski. Far side. It's outside for Daniel Sedin. Mishandles the puck slightly here. Now drops it back for Salo. Snaps it across for Olin. Winds up. Drives a shot. Shiger will save. Big carom off the end board. Daniel Sedin now hands it off for Nelson. Another penalty coming. And it's going to go against Anaheim. And the Canucks want to give the puck away here as soon as they can. Unless they have a clear scoring chance. Olin hands it off for the corner. Daniel Sedin centering pass. And it'll be touched here by Anaheim. And with still 37 seconds remaining, it's Scott Niedermeyer's penalty.
Chris Pronger is going to join him. That's your top two defensemen. In every situation, you want one of these two players on the ice, but it's going to be Pronger that's going to go to the box to join Niedermeyer.
Anaheim, 25, minor penalty hooking.
Some good pressure with a man advantage by Vancouver. That lively rebound off the backboards. Again, the stick work, and you can see the reaction by Pronger. Kind of looking upwards, saying, no, I can't believe you called that. But he's going to go to the box for a hook. The top two defensemen, who you would love to have at least one of them here in this 5-on-3 against.
Faceoff control by the Canucks. Here is Salo, hands it off now for Naslin. Naslin waits patiently. Back to Salo, a drive. Shakir somehow the save with Daniel Sedin right in his face.
Sedin's exactly where he should be, at the top of the crease, not in the shaded blue area, but right at the top. He wants to be directly in front of Shiger in an alignment with the shot. The feed back to Salo at the right point. He wants to get this shot right away, get it through. There's the traffic. Great concentration. That lead left by Shiger, Dave, to get a good look.
28 seconds left in the 5-on-3. Paulson won it back, but the Canucks outnumbering the Ducks. Get to it. Now it's taken away by Paulson. He got a big clear. Henrik Sedin rushes it right back. Put it off the skate of Boschman. A costly mishandle there, but credit Boschman for getting in the passing lane. Look how aggressive the Ducks are, even two men short of the neutral zone. And Salo hands it off for Naslin. 5 seconds left in the 5-on-3. Henrik Sedin across for Salo, top of the circle. Hands it low now. Daniel Sedin takes a look in front. 5-on-4 power play. Naslin drive stopped. Shiger gave up a rebound, but it's the Ducks that get there and clear.
In the 5-on-3, the Ducks really take a lot of time off that 5-on-3, and it all started with a face-off win by Sammy Paulson.
Well, the Canucks managed three shots during that 5-on-3. They continue with a minute remaining in the penalty to Pronger now. It comes back along the boards, taken away by Rob Niedermeyer. He'll hoist it all the way down, and Luongo will settle it there. Now Sopel, side of his own net, starting it back. Backhand feed now for Olin, and Olin drives it along the boards behind Jaguar. It comes to Morrison, he lets it go. Sopel moves it along, intercepted by Getzlaff. He'll start it back now with Taylor Pyatt chasing him. And Pyatt eventually knocked it away. Now it comes back to number 9 for Vancouver. Hyatt cuts to the outside on Scott Niedermeyer, who angles him well. 20 seconds left in this Vancouver power play. Now the puck is cleared around by Sean O'Donnell, recovered by Sopel. Sopel takes a look. Hands it off at the hash marks for Morrison. His pass knocked away. Scott Niedermeyer up the board with a bouncing puck. Is cleared outside the line. Good work there by Travis Moen. And now Matias Olin has to drop it back as the Canucks regroup. And the penalty to Pronger is over. Anaheim back at full strength. Krychek being pressured by Solani. Now Olin trying to move it along. Anaheim 5-on-5 now with their big line. They're going to try to get the forecheck. Centering attempt by Solani. He had Andy McDonald going to the front of the net. Taken now by Burrows for Vancouver. Lobs it in wide as Jaguar. Huskin battling there with Hansen. And taken now by McDonald, who had the 4-point game in game one. Here is the shifty number 19. Pulls up rim of the circle. Hands it back to the line. DePenta with a shot saved by Luongo. Could hear it hit the blocker. Now Hansen able to get it to Burrows. Right side for Josh Green. Avoids one Anaheim player and dumps the puck in behind Jaguar. Stronger from behind his own net. Waiting for the line change to complete.
With all the penalties now all sorted out, the special teams put away. The Getzlaff, Penner, Perry line have a chance to get back on the ice.
Here is Getzlaff now. Plays it first in the corner. Now Perry takes over. Corey Perry back to the line for Pronger. Through traffic. That didn't get to Luongo. Edler given a shove off the puck there by Getzlaff. And it comes out near the line. The long reach of Pronger holds it in. He lobs it in wide. Here's Corey Perry for Penner off the end board. Getzlaff fakes one way. Goes the other. Still has it on the forehand. Off the boards now O'Donnell to Pronger. Straight away a drive just wide. Again, Pronger so good at getting pucks by the first guy coming at him. That's the important thing.
And then the confidence of O'Donnell to use his power. And he knows it has to be a quick pass and it has to be accurate because there will be some pressure.
Well, the crowd wanted a penalty there on Corey Perry. He may have gotten away with a quick grab of the jersey. And back the other way now. It is sent in by Cowan. Sokol, the defenseman, gets in there. Puck is knocked free. It'll be recovered here by Moan. And then Moan plays it out to center ice. Naslund back to get it. Hands it off now for Olin. 7 minutes straight up left here in the first. And this play is offside. Dustin Penner has game three's only goal. 1-0 Anaheim. You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus. Was the unlikely hero in overtime, but you have to give credit to the four regular defensemen that were left for Vancouver with Bieksa and Salo out. And take a look at what these four guys, Olin, Sokol, Krajicek, and Mitchell, combined to do.
Yeah, look at the average ice time for the four of them, over 33 minutes. Now, keep in mind, Mitchell missed significant time in the first period with a leg injury, 14 shots on goal. They get pucks through, and I know it was a double overtime game, but that's doing an excellent job of being involved entirely, five-man attack, and then the 15 shot blocks, that's impressive as well. Everybody involved in the penalty killing, and the penalty killing has been very strong for Vancouver. When you get the goaltending, the penalty killing, even when you're not scoring goals, you can still win games.
And yes, Anaheim did have seven power play opportunities in game two, but of those four defensemen, they only took two minor penalties. Those guys had to be on the ice, and they were.
Yeah, the discipline, they showed it very well, and they led the way for a team that needed them to lead the way.
1-0 Ducks here in this game three. Winner of this game will take a 2-1 lead into game four that'll be played here on Tuesday night. Hyatt with a steal in the neutral zone. Pulls up on the far board. Scott Niedermayer closed the gap there quickly. And now Pyatt with it. Trying to walk up the board. Now it comes loose. Henrik Sedin got a stick on it. Travis Moan now will take a bump from Pyatt, but Moan able to clear it back into the Vancouver zone. Pass now for Burrows. Scott Niedermayer stepped into him. Now here's Boschman. We had to step up big in that 5-on-3 shorthanded situation. You talked about the fact that it was Scott Niedermayer and Pronger in the box. How nice is it to have a Boschman that can come out in that 5-on-3 shorthanded?
I mean, they're deep on defense, but to have those three, impressive.
Here's Solani, fakes, goes wide, tries to hand it off now to McDonald. That's poked away. And Burrows being bothered there by May, but the Canucks will come up with it. Brad May getting some time there with McDonald and Solani, and May with a big hit behind the play on Sokol. Here's May in front of the Anaheim bench. Slides it across, looking for Ryan Shannon. It's knocked away. Here is Edler. Now for Salo, back to the young defenseman number 23 for Vancouver. Edler, Salo, right wing side. Trevor Linden gets it to Smolinski, hands it off. Here's Bullock for the chance, the save to Gare, and it nearly went in off an Anaheim defenseman. But it is covered by Jaguar. Dustin Penner has the only goal, but Vancouver comes close. It remains 1-0 Ducks. Jack Edwards from Hockey Central on the other side of this. All right, Jack, thanks very much. And I'm sure they're going to talk about that goal that was disallowed in that Ranger-Buffalo game. It was ruled to be a distinct kicking motion. And I think the wrong call was made. The call on the ice was a good goal, and I never thought as I watched the various replays that it was a distinct kicking motion.
Yeah, I would have counted it as a goal too, Dave, but you know what? In doing games during the regular season, I saw those goals disallowed, and I disagreed with them during the regular season, but they were consistent to make that call.
1-0 is the score here. Dustin Penner has the only goal for the Anaheim Ducks. Here in this game three, Western Conference semifinals. Brendan Morrison has checked on the play. Now it's taken over by Kunitz. He takes a look, sees McDonald. Well, McDonald gets the shot away and missed the net. And now here is Cowan. Chips it ahead now into the Anaheim zone. I know they're going to talk a lot about it in that first intermission, but I would use a phrase that's often used by the NHL hockey operation. Is it a hockey play? And I think when a player's going to the net and putting on the break, that's a hockey play. There's no way he could get his skate out of the way. And I think if your skate doesn't leave the ice, maybe they need to put that verbiage in the casebook for future situations. I think if the skate doesn't leave the ice, there's no danger. It should be a good goal.
Yeah, they're trying to cut down on contact with goaltenders. You've got to put brakes on when you get into that area. And then what about the non-penalty call on the play if you're not going to allow the goal?
Exactly. Now Bowen hands it off for Rob Niedermayer. Tries to get by Olin, who played him well on the far side. Now Daniel Sedin gets over.
Olin got hurt on that play, Dave.
Yeah, he is struggling getting to the bench, and there's a penalty coming against Anaheim. Here's Pyatt with a shot that's blocked up on the netting and out of play. And so Vancouver will get their third power play opportunity of this first period.
Yeah, it's going to be Rob Niedermayer this game.
Number 44, Anaheim, minor penalty for slashing.
Matthias Olin, who's trying to protect along the sideboards in a defensive posture against Rob Niedermayer, squeezes him off. Niedermayer makes contact with that stanchion, as does Olin. Olin quickly turns around and goes right back to the bench, and then when Niedermayer picks himself up, the chop on the stick of Sedin is going to lead to the slashing call.
The slashing on Rob Niedermayer. And again, when will Vancouver make Anaheim pay for going to the box? The shots right now in the game are 11 for Vancouver and 2 for Anaheim. But one of those two shots for the Ducks has gotten through, and that was the one by Dustin Penner at 3:08. His first of this series, second of the playoffs, and fifth of his career. And so the Vancouver Canucks now 3 for 52 on the power play in these playoffs. Go to work again. Sopel with a shot, missed the net high and wide. Haslin tried to make a play on it. Puck comes free, and Travis Moen for Anaheim sets it down the ice.
There have been some seams in Anaheim's defense in their own zone through this first period, as reflected by those 11 shots on goal. There's been some good quality scoring chances. You got to look for a guy like Taylor Pyatt to work the front of the net. That's where the openings have been.
The Nuts held it in, but they put it to an open area, and the first one there was Pronger. Now here comes Luongo out of the net. Leaves it for Sopel. Kunitz trying to give him a shove. Kunitz was probably Anaheim's best hitter in that game, too, the other night, delivering several hard body checks. Edward Sedin trying to stick handle through three white jerseys, and it's the Canucks that have the man advantage, but they're a little slow making a change, and the Ducks had him outnumbered at the puck.
Yeah, not a good decision right there by Sedin to try to carry that puck in by himself with three Ducks all around him.
Good! Now Daniel Sedin trying to get by Boschman, who reached out with a stick. Daniel Sedin went down, but Boschman got the puck and cleared it. Now Olin plays it around the boards behind Jaguar. Chipped away by Scott Niedermayer, and Moen finishes the clear. Now Olin backing up. Hands it off for Salo. 25 seconds left in the Rob Niedermayer minor penalty. Minute 40 left here in the first period of this game three. Scott Niedermayer able to clear. Tough as it is to look at the Vancouver power play numbers, if you're a Canuck fan, this Anaheim penalty killing in this series and going back to their first round win over Minnesota, their penalty killing numbers terrific.
And they really stand up in their defensive blue line.
The puck is knocked away and it's cleared over the glass and out of play. And just as Rob Niedermayer comes out of the box, I think an Anaheim player is going right in.
Yeah, it's going to be Getzlaff.
Let's go downstairs to Billy Jaffe.
All right, thanks a lot, Dave, as we hear the delay of game call from referee Mark Joinette. You know, Andy Brickley, from ice level down here, watching the Canucks on their breakout, it's been a little bit better in this game, but as soon as they get to the offensive blue line, they're making these soft passes, kind of the hope plays to get the puck in. And weren't you always taught you don't make a pass right at the blue line, make sure you get it deep, at least below the hash marks? Canucks haven't been able to do that so far.
Exactly right, Billy, and when you do that, you're going to just lead into turnovers, and that's not something you want to do. You've had a pretty good period. Don't give Anaheim anything to build on. Their penalty killing has been good. But make better decisions in the neutral zone. That's where this game could be won.
Here you see the Canucks' overall numbers, including the 0 for 3 tonight. This is power play number 4. Remember, they had Nearly a minute of a 5-on-3 earlier in the period. A centering pass all over the chance. Save rebound. Score! Marcus Naslund has tied the game at 1.
Marcus Naslund had the best chance of this first period on the first shift of this game. And now he's tied it here in the final minute with a power play goal. The ability to make plays in tight areas. Beautiful feed out front by Naslund. The quick vision before he gets the puck to know that he has Olin wide open in between the hash marks. Olin with a quick release. The goal cam view of Naslund coming out of the corner to corral the puck with his feet. Now he's got a wide open net. Great play by Naslund. Good release by Olin. But the puck possession and the good, tight, close support in order to get that puck in the corner of the rink.
And I know you felt that Naslund's first goal of game two should not be overlooked with all the heroics of Jeff Cowan.
Now we talked about the importance of your role players doing the job, but your good players have to be good too. And Naslund had struggled in terms of production in the entire playoffs. I thought that first goal was huge in game two. And don't forget Trevor Linden's play on the game winner. He's leading Vancouver in points in the postseason coming into tonight.
Now it comes to Solani, right wing boards. Checked by Willie Mitchell, the two number eights battle. Now Bulis and Mitchell working to try to clear. Scott Niedermeyer with a good stick kept it in, and now Bulis does get it out as the horn sounds to end the first period.
Big period for Vancouver, especially the final couple of minutes after a giveaway goal by their star goaltender, Roberto Luongo. They needed to get something, and I'll tell you, no better news in terms of good news for Vancouver that they score on the power play.
So the guys in Hockey Central will be coming your way. Jack Edwards, Keith Jones, and Brian Engblom. Right here it is, 1-1 after 20 minutes of play in Game 3 of the Western Semifinals. You're watching the Stanley Cup Playoffs on Versus.
Predicted the goal by Naslund in the final minute on the power play to tie this thing.
Again, four minor penalties in that first period, all against the Anaheim Ducks. Kunitz, McDonald, Solani, the Sedins, and Pyatt go head-to-head just as they did in the first shift of the game. They start off the second period, and Solani sends it along the boards behind Luongo up the near side. Kunitz sends it back in deep now. Mitchell along the boards for Daniel Sedin, and now here's Henrik Sedin with it. Tries to hand it back to his brother. It's tipped away by Boschman. Recovered by Henrik Sedin. Daniel in the corner, Pyatt dumped in front of the net. Now it comes out to Paulson, and Paulson for Anaheim slides it across. Boschman, a nice feed here for Solani into the zone. Leans into a shot that's blocked up on the netting and out of play. Let's go downstairs to Bill Jaffe.
Time for some coaches report. First one I talked with was Anaheim's assistant Dave Farish. Very happy with how the first period went, believe it or not, even though just two shots on goal. Yeah, he admitted maybe some jitters early from some of our younger players, but the message in the second, the refs are calling it tight. Keep your legs moving. Let's stay out of the box. Go to the Vancouver bench, assistant Barry Smith. He talked about too many one-on-ones at the offensive blue line on the power play. Sound familiar, Brick? You and I talked about that. He said, look, the good news in that first period, puck battles. We won a lot of them. We got the puck down low, especially 5-on-5. We won some board battles, and boy, was that power play important for our team. Back upstairs.
Billy Vancouver also very good in game two in that area, the one-on-one battles. The power play, maybe it starts to feel a little better about itself because of the last-minute power play goal by Naslund. You know, all of a sudden, you stop trying to be an individual, and you stop trying to make plays at the offensive blue line, and better things start to happen with the man advantage. And absolutely right, the assistant coaches for Anaheim, keep your feet moving, stay out of the box. That's why they only had two shots on goal.
1-1, and let's take a look, Brick, at the two goals.
Yeah, well, it started with a bad play by Roberto Luongo. He comes out to play the puck, but he kind of heals his wrap around the boards. Corey Perry with a beautiful read and a wide open Dustin Penner for a layup goal. And then on their fourth power play opportunity, finally able to cash in with the man advantage. Great play by Naslund on the pass and then the follow back to the front of the net to handle it with his feet.
Here is Pronger now again, hearing the boos whenever he touches the puck here at General Motors Place. Pronger, long pass. It's deflected by Perry. Tried to hit Getzlaff in stride. Olin tries to clear Penner with a steal. Save made by Luongo. That puck caromed around a couple of times. Back to the line on a shot here by Pronger, was blocked by Cowan. And that puck kind of pinballed after it came off the stick of Penner, and right here just offside on the play at the Vancouver blue line.
Well, Anaheim trying to use that stretch forward on the breakout. The long distance pass by Pronger deep in his own zone. This young line, impressive line, gets Lapierre and Penner, getting some offensive pressure as a result. But a good shot block when the puck went back to Pronger for a second opportunity. Cowan stepping right in the shooting lane.
Noah Faceoff right in front of the Anaheim bench. Smolinski for the Canucks. Lost the draw there to McDonald, and it's driven in by Huskins behind Luongo. Mitchell plays it around right wing side. Kunitz there to block it. Gives it back to McDonald. Spins away from Krychek. And McDonald goes the other way. Andy McDonald with 14 shots in the first two games of this series. He first had that big, as I mentioned earlier, the four-point night in game one to lead the way. Would have been offside here. The Ducks recognize. They come back, regroup. Now Kunitz will tip it in and avoids a Trevor Linden attempted hit. Now Krychek had to go off his stick. Willie Mitchell now safely to Bulis at center ice. Jan Bulis will lift it in. Wide of J.S. Jaguar. Huskins back to play it. No carry to center ice. Broken up by Bulis. Now it comes back to DePenta. Taken away by Green. Gets a shot off of the angle and lifted it too high over the glove of Jaguar, and it's slapped back through the neutral zone.
Nice read by Green, but it was good pressure by Bulis. Bulis had a very good first period. Three shots on goal. Two of those shots were quality scoring chances.
There is Kunitz now. He'll lift it and try to get it deep. That hit off one of the stanchions. That sends Vancouver back the other way. Here's Hansen. Winds up, fakes, walks to his man, and then it was poked away. Pronger with that long reach. And Ryan Shannon, a little bank pass here now for May. May and Olin tie each other up. Now Green nearly run over there by Sean Thornton as Randy Carlisle trying to shake things up here with his fourth line coming out early in this second period. Maybe turn things around a bit for the Anaheim Ducks, who still have only three shots on goal in this game, as this one goes wide of the glove of Jaguar, and back the other way comes Thornton, and he'll send it in deep. Edler taking off the puck, Salo there to support. Brad May got a piece of that puck, but it's cleared by Taylor Pyatt to Henrik Sedin. Briefly in the Anaheim zone, Scott Niedermeyer for Travis Moan. Well, Rob Niedermeyer was in there ahead of the puck offside.
Well, just when Anaheim wants to use that dump off the glass and try to get a little offensive forecheck going, or perhaps complete a line change, the puck's going to take a funny carom off the glass and then quick transition. How about this move by Yannick Hansen? Steps around Pronger. Just when you think you got a guy like Pronger beat, in comes that long reach. Great recovery by the veteran defense, but otherwise Hansen was in on Jaguar.
Hansen did not dress for game one. Elaine Vigneault opting to go with Nathan Smith. That they thought they needed a little bit more grit, and they found out, you know what, we need a little bit more speed. And Hansen certainly brings that, and had five shots on goal in that game two victory. Playing in the playoffs for the first time in his career, a call-up during the playoffs. Played a little bit during the regular season. Now McDonald lops it in wide of Luongo. Here's Mitchell back to play it, being pursued by Kunitz. Now Andy McDonald with a steal on the boards. Solani behind the net, takes one way, goes the other. Off the boards for Scott Niedermeyer, quickly to the net. Save Luongo, gave up a rebound. And the sound of blue for Luongo from the GM Place crowd. Now McDonald across the red line, into the Vancouver zone. Solani winds up, a drive was blocked. And it comes all the way out to Morrison. He's got Cowan way over on the left side. Mitchell coming late. Mitchell will take the pass. His shot. Save, rebound. Just wide by Cowan. He tries to wrap it in front and hit the post. Jeff Cowan's almost had his third goal of this series. That would have been a three-game playoff goal-scoring streak. Now Henrik Sedin puts on the break. Oh, and he lost control of the puck. And it's flipped by Boschman, but not out here. Sofel, he'll drive a shot wide as Jaguar. Daniel Sedin was upended there. It may have been by the goal stick of Jaguar, but no call. Paulson ridden to the board by Sofel. Henrik Sedin bumped by Rob Niedermeyer. 14:40 remaining here in the second period. 1-1 our score in game three of a series that's tied at one. Taylor Pyatt had to work it ahead. He got it outside the zone, and here's Travis Moan with it for Anaheim.
So much of your transition game comes from shot blocks, and that's what led to the chance by Mitchell and the follow-up by Collins.
A little outlet pass here now. Boulos, one-on-one against Pronger. Waits, and Pronger just kept the man in front of him, sweeps it down the ice. And this will be icing on the touch-up.
Well, after Anaheim had a rush to the neutral zone, they think they're going to get a shot in the direction of Roberto Luongo after Luongo had made an early left-pad save. And then in transition, Mitchell up ice. He takes that feed. His quick release is handled with the glove as you hear. Watch Cowan getting to the front of the net. Rebound chance on the backhand. Stays with it. Just didn't have enough time or space to get back out from behind the net on that wraparound second opportunity. Some great work by Cowan in transition.
Faceoff win by the Ducks, and O'Donnell able to get the clear. There was Salo now. Waits. Patient with it. Hands it off for Smolinski. Went by him. Recovered here by the Ducks. And Pronger leap pass for Corey Perry. Just slapped away by Salo. Penner has the Anaheim goal. Naslin has the Vancouver goal. Both coming in the first. We're here on the second, tied at one. Trevor Linden. Drop pass was behind Boulos. And back the other way now comes Getzlaff. Getzlaff across the line. Penner goes to the net. Getzlaff a drive. Save Luongo. Getzlaff, can he ever shoot a puck? Now Linden across the line. Waits, hands it off. Smolinski, backhand shot in the glove of Jaguar, and he holds it there. Rick Bonus, assistant coach of the Vancouver Canucks, will visit with Billy Jaffe when we come back.
Welcome back to Vancouver. 1-1 is the score. Coach, want to know how about the matchups tonight? How favorable they've been for you to help keep Anaheim from getting a lot of shots on net?
Well, Randy's getting the matchups he wants, and both teams are changing a lot on the fly. We're changing more on the face-off control situations, and they're changing on the fly. So it's more important for us to get our defense out we want Willie Mitchell out against Solani, and we want Ole out in the offensive situations, things like that. So we'll take the matchups the way they're going right now. We'll take the flow the way it's going right now. But it's important with matchups to control the face-off circle. Then you're controlling your matchups.
Well, you've done a good job of that, too. Thanks for joining us here. Back upstairs, guys.
And just as Coach Bonus said that, not a good control of the face-off for Vancouver, but they do come right back as Sopel tries to feed it to the front of the net. Burrows was jamming the net there as he was being checked by DePenta. Now Burrows trying to feed it back to the point. Olin is waiting there. Corey Perry without a stick here for Anaheim. Still tries to make a play, and he did, but I think he's going to be called.
Perry reaching out with the free hand without his stick after Olin makes a nice play in the offensive zone right by the offensive blue line to keep this play alive. The idea was good. Put the puck in the area.
Number 10, minor penalty, holding
of the player without the stick. And it was Perry that did not have it. See at the top of your screen, Perry going down, trying to play with his shin pad, reaches out with both hands, grabs the leg and skate of Olin. And that's going to lead to the penalty call.
Yeah, right there.
Here.
Yeah.
Pretty good open field tackle.
Yeah, it was. Power play number 5. Keep in mind, the Canucks yet to take a minor penalty in this game, and the Canucks' only goal came on that fourth power play chance late in period 1.
Ryan Shannon was on the ice, and diminutive sentiment, trying to handle the puck deep in his own zone. Good pressure by Vancouver to free him of the puck, and that led to the continued pressure, and therefore the penalty to Corey Perry.
Here's Matias Olin now. He and Salo playing the points on this power play. The Ducks with only 5 shots on goal to this point of the game, 15 for Vancouver. Scott Niedermeyer finds an opening and hammers it all the way down the ice. The entry so important on a power play, Brick, and Vancouver not able to get it in there cleanly.
Especially the way Anaheim defends. This is the type of attack sometimes you have to use, those high lobs, throw it in areas where you can retrieve it.
Here is Salo, slides it across. Olin tees it up for a drive, tip, and Jaguar wasn't sure that he had it. But the Sedin twins were right there, and so is Trevor Linden. I think there's going to be any other calls here. Now, Daniel Sedin and Henrik, we talked about their lack of production on the road during these playoffs. They don't have a point in 5 road playoff games. They've been productive at home. What's ironic is that Daniel Sedin among 30 goal scorers in the National Hockey League this year. Look at that, 23 of 36 goals. The only other 30 goal scorer that scored a higher percentage of his goals on the road was Jason Pominville of Buffalo. But it's not happening for Daniel so far in these playoffs in terms of scoring on the road. But right here, they've got these next two games in this building. Salo to the net. That hit a skate. And Travis Moan comes up with it. He'll clear for Anaheim. Already halfway through the penalty against Corey Perry. Vancouver hasn't come close to threatening. Morrison sends it across. Sean O'Donnell there. It's going to be a penalty here against Vancouver. Going to be called a hook.
Going to be on Naslin. And three minor penalties last game to go along with his big goal, the first goal for Vancouver. Morrison's going to step into the offensive zone
Vancouver,
after taking a pass.
19, minor penalty, hooking.
Through the neutral zone, and he wants to go from side to side to find Naslin coming in off the off wing. The pass almost connects. Some good stick work by O'Donnell, and then their skates actually lock up, and that's what led to O'Donnell leaning forward, trying to get to that loose puck and going to the ice. But in the eyes of the officials, that was a hook.
Well, he saw the swinging motion of the stick combined with the player going down, and that's what can happen so often. Four skaters aside, 35 seconds before Corey Perry comes out. And if we don't have any other calls, Anaheim will have their first power play chance here of this game three. Henrik Sedin pushes it along. Daniel tries to get it back to him up the boards for Lucas Krajicek. Henrik Sedin protecting the puck well. Boschman trying to check him with the stick and held on for a split second. Now Henrik sends it to the side of the net. Jaguar leaves it there for Scott Niedermeyer. Now for Paulson, back for the Anaheim captain. Corey Perry getting set to come out of the box. He hits the ice. Power play for Anaheim. Boschman holds on, waits, circles the net. Looks out in front, deflected Scott Niedermeyer, a backhand. A lot of traffic around the logo. And now we get a whistle to halt play.
Well, this all starts in the defensive zone. Good job by Paulson to work in tandem with Niedermeyer, and then allows Niedermeyer to carry this puck through center ice. He's able to lay this puck across to Boschman. Good decisions here by Boschman. Surveys what's going on in the offensive zone, uses the net as an ally, and even though Kunitz kind of fans on that one-time opportunity, you can see Luongo already committed to what he expected to be a shot, and then that loose puck, you got both Kunitz and Niedermeyer following the play up, and Luongo able to hold his ground with no second opportunities for Anaheim.
Anaheim's power play so far in the playoffs, 7 for 35, operating at 20%. Just 2 for 16 so far in this series. McDonald scoops it along. Here's Kunitz behind the net. Looking out in front, snaps the pass to Perry out for Pronger. Thought about the one-timer. Pronger straight away. He'll get this through. Save rebound chance. Kunitz. Now Boschman is there. Score! Puck is in the net. Yes, it's a goal on the power play. And Anaheim has regained the lead.
Because you have Pronger and Niedermeyer, they work the umbrella, two-thirds of it on one side, and you have a good shooter like Perry set up on the other side of the umbrella, it spreads out the defense. It spreads out the penalty killer. Solpa's going to keep an eye on Perry, and what that does is it frees up a better shooting lane for Pronger. Get pucks through. Pronger's one of the best at it. Quick little wrist shot, and then you try to outnumber your opponent directly in front of the net. It appears to be a two-on-two, but because the shot is high and Luongo has to handle it with the left shoulder, and you got a defenseman, Boschman, crashing the net with your forwards working the front of the net, that's your outnumbered situation. And sometimes the puck just finds you in those situations, Dave, and Boschman able to snap that puck home.
Well, Francois Boschman with the power play goal, and well, that's the difference in your special teams coming up huge. Vancouver had five power plays, converted on one. Anaheim gets one that's less than a full 2 minutes, and yet they convert. As Luongo steers this puck, it hit the referee. Comes to Rob Niedermeyer. Out to Sean O'Donnell with a shot. That skipped wide, picked up by Paulson on the far side. Goals and just seven shots, and a penalty coming here, and it's going to go against the Vancouver Canucks. Here's O'Donnell with it. Now Rob Niedermeyer again. Extra attack around now for Anaheim. Rob Niedermeyer trying to spin away from Mitchell. They jam it out to O'Donnell left point, sends it across for Pronger. Now for Rob Niedermeyer. O'Donnell again. Hands it off on the near board. Paulson between the circles. Rob Niedermeyer saved Luongo and he holds it there. Well, Corey Perry will be our interview with Billy Jaffe when we come back. You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs on First Line.
Back to GM Place, 2 on the score, Ducks over the Canucks. I've got Corey Perry here. Corey, I want to go back to the first goal of the game that your Lions scored. Was there something that you picked up in Roberto Luongo's play or in his eyes that led you to stay on that wall and intercept that pass?
Well, Getzy went to the other side of the net and just can't get beat along the wall with the rim. And, you know, I just stood along the wall, got the pass, and I just saw Penz in front all by himself. So, you know, it's one of those things, just went in the net.
Went in the net, I'd say a very nice play. Good luck the rest of the way. Thanks for joining us.
All right, thank you.
All right, Corey Perry here. Dave, Andy, back up to you.
And a power play again here for the Anaheim Ducks. They have just taken the lead on a power play goal. Here's a snapshot. Luongo, the save. He got that with the left arm as Andy McDonald. A seeing eye shot that got through somehow. Now McDonald walks it back up the wall. Top of the circle. Centering pass is blocked. Comes right to Perry. Perry sends it back to the point. Pronger for McDonald. McDonald fakes one way. Hands it back to Pronger. Now McDonald, long one-timer. Kind of misfired on it. Gloves aside by Sallow. Now Kunitz for McDonald. Boschman's goal, his first of this series, third of the playoffs, sixth of his career. Now McDonald looking down low. They try to stuff it in, and Luongo has everything covered there. Loose puck, but the referee had lost sight of it.
Well, you get a look at some of the young guys on this power play. The first power play unit for Anaheim. Look what they did during the regular season. Perry with his 17, Getzlaf 25, Penner 29 goals, and they picked right up in the playoffs. They didn't expect any kind of sophomore jinx for these young players. They've lived up to expectations, and they're doing it in the postseason. A total of 6 goals and 10 assists between those 3 players.
A bright future for Anaheim. Short-term and long-term, it looks like. And Solani had it slapped away by Edler. Olin moved it along behind his own net. And Getzlaf tried to make a play, taken away by Bulis. Deflected up to the line where it's held in by Pronger. There's Pronger, backhand pass, Getzlaf now. Takes a look, top of the circle, winds up. Hands it off for Solani, tried to get it back to Getzlaf. Tipped away by Bulis, but he could not get it by Pronger. Now Penner off the boards for Scott Niedermeyer. Intercepted by Bulis. He'll start it back down the ice shorthanded and just send it in deep.
It was a good pass by Niedermeyer. He had Penner breaking back, a little simple give and go. I think Penner thought he was going to go back to Pronger. Wasn't looking for it.
Pronger drives it along the boards. Burrows for Vancouver sends it back the other way. Solani is there. Chips it back to Pronger. 20 seconds left on this power play. Solani takes a look. Doesn't see anything he likes. Now sends it across, Getzlaf, top of the circle, drives the shot, blocked toward the net, and Penner nearly got a stick on it as Luongo was trying to battle that puck when it was up in the air. Getzlaf again makes a nice move, drops it back for Pronger. Far side now, Scott Niedermeyer, final seconds of this power play. Getzlaf a drive, save Luongo. Mitchell comes out of the box. Now here's Solani, centering pass for Penner. Don't know if that got all the way through, but it's cleared to center ice. And Mitchell now sends it in deep behind Jaguar. Pronger, little chip pass for Rob Niedermeyer. Checked on the play by Naslin. Recovered, though, by the Ducks. Two shots for Anaheim on that last power play. They've had 4 shots with the man advantage. So power play working for Anaheim. Getting a goal, changing the momentum here. Now here's Naslin on the angle. His shot deflected wide as Jaguar. Rob Niedermeyer bumped there by Cowan. Paulson trying to get it out. And the puck toward the blue line. Who's going to win the race for the puck? It's won there by Sokol. Then he mishandled. Picked his head up. He was going to have a great scoring chance after winning a race to the puck. And now it's another race back into the Vancouver zone. And Moan with a big hit.
Not only did he win the race to the puck in front of Pronger, how about a little move he made to step around him? Self-pass.
Now Moan with a steal. Sends it back. Rob Niedermeyer. Taken to the boards by Sokol. Niedermeyer gets himself free from that check, sets it up here, and Paulson's shot doesn't get through. Boschman hustling back, being watched by Henrik Sedin. Now the puck stolen by Daniel Sedin behind the net, rolls it in front. Tipped away by McDonald. And now the Canucks regroup center ice. Lukas Krajicek hammers it behind Jaguar on the far side. Daniel Sedin is there. Chips it along Taylor Kyatt. Checked by Bozeman. Pie and wrapper on hold. Roll to the crease. Score! Daniel Sedin picked up a loose puck. We have a 2-2 game.
The Sedins, they like to cycle the puck. They welcome the body contact because of their ability to make plays in tight areas in the offensive zone. You add Taylor Pyatt to that mix with his size and strength and his ability to take the puck to the net. And the constant pressure by Vancouver and the Sedin twins going to tie this hockey game. Almost appears that Jagr actually gets a piece of this shot by Sedin. But I think it's going to bang off the right side of Jagr's body. Could sneak up under that crossbar short side. Tied hockey game. Good follow-up pressure. Good relentless follow-up pressure by Vancouver after some quality scoring chances at the opposite end with Anaheim in their power play.
First goal of these playoffs for Daniel Sedin, the regular season leading goal scorer since the first goal of the playoffs in game one against the Dallas Stars. Daniel Sedin has scored to tie game 3-2. You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus. Jack 2-2 our score, and identical twins. I guess we shouldn't be surprised with that goal by Daniel. Both Daniel and Henrik have two goals, both have two assists, and they've done all their scoring here at General Motors Place.
Yeah, and they've been in big games in the sense that the first game of the playoffs against Dallas, they went four overtimes. They're big in that one, and then the decisive game seven, big in that one.
Gets off a shot. Corey Perry screening in front, and how about Luongo getting his glove up as Perry tried to bat it down with his glove? And traffic again is what the Ducks are trying to create in front of Roberto Luongo.
Yeah, don't hurt your momentum by turning the puck over in your own end after you just tied the hockey game. Make better decisions, make better execution on the breakouts or the attempted breakouts, higher percentage plays. Don't turn that puck over in tops of the circles on down. But if you do, you got Luongo in goal, and he's able to handle the pressure, grab that puck, that loose puck with his glove.
Faceoff win Canucks, and it camps it into the zone. Gets it by O'Donnell. Pronger comes over to help out. Big hit by Pronger on Hanson. Now Alex Burrows pushing it along the boards. It comes out to the line. Here's Matthias Olin with a shot that hit a skate. And Sean Thornton now trying to lift it back the other way. Bouncing puck. Brad May coming in. He came close to throwing an elbow there at Sopel.
He threw it, just didn't connect.
Just a bit outside. O'Donnell for Sean Thornton. Deflects now into the Vancouver zone. And Shannon giving a shove there. It's cleared up the left wing board. Burrows able to slide it across. It won't come out, though. Boschman's going to hold it in. Now it's cleared to the line, and Boschman bats it across the neutral zone. And this is ruled a hand pass as we take a look at the Dodge storyline. Anaheim's goals coming from Penner and Boschman. Boschman on the power play, and Vancouver getting their goals from their captain right there. Naslin on a power play late in the first period. And of course, Daniel Sedin, as you take a look at the shots in Anaheim, Brickhead certainly closed the gap in terms of shots on goal.
Well, yeah, there hasn't been the lopsidedness of the power play opportunities that we saw in game one, but both teams have played extremely hard. Both goaltenders have been pretty good. We haven't talked a lot of Jagr. I thought he was outstanding in period number one, particularly in the first 7-8 minutes of this hockey game.
Now Cowan, rink wide pass. Naslin collects it with a skate and flips it in wide to Jagr. Cowan moves it along now for Morrison, trying to spin off the Kunitz check. Now behind the net, Cowan couldn't get a stick on it. Pronger. Cowan went after him up high, and now the puck taken over by Naslin into the zone. Naslin gets the shot away just wide as Jagr. Looked a little bit awkward. And the Ducks come out with it. Here's Solani. Relatively quiet here in this game three so far. He had the goal in game one and so many chances in game two. Now Pronger. Send it along the boards. Morrison knocked it down. Morrison, that's a dangerous flip, but he got it outside the line. And Sean O'Donnell drops it back for Pronger up the middle. Kunitz. Kunitz into the zone, right side now. McDonald sets it up. Here's Sean O'Donnell. He just mishandled it for a second. Well, that was a heads-up pass by McDonald. Under 3 minutes remaining here now in this second period. Good aggressive play by Mitchell with the hit and the takeaway.
Unfortunate mishandled by O'Donnell because he had Solani in the slot.
Niedermeyer, long bank pass. Moan could not handle it cleanly. Now it comes to Henrik Sedin. Trips it to the middle of the ice. Sent back to the boards. O'Donnell had it knocked away. Daniel Sedin walks out in front. Save made by Jaguar. Still a loose puck for Pyatt. And that was stopped in front. And Rob Niedermeyer back the other way. Trying to play his own pass around Edler. Loose puck rolling in toward Luongo. Now it's picked up by Rob Niedermeyer. Couldn't get much on it. And Edler plays it along on the far side. Daniel Sedin bumped there by Travis Moan. Just over 2 minutes remaining now. Here in the second period. Paulson hands it off. Moan on the angle. Shot got through. Save. Rebound chance here. Scott Niedermeyer passes it across. Moan, a drive was blocked by Edler. What a nice pass that was by Scott Niedermeyer. I thought he was just going to shoot it. He recognized that perhaps a teammate on the far side would have a better chance. A backhander here is stopped by Luongo. And play continues as the crowd again with the chant of Lou for the work of Luongo.
I won't say it's a lost art, but you don't see a whole lot of backhanders that hard from that distance that have a chance to go in. It's like we got matching penalties here on the stick work, on the initial contact, and perhaps the embellishment on the dive.
Well, the two referees are trying to get the attention of everybody, and Marcus Naslund, the captain, is going to come over here and have something to say to the referee, Mark Jonette.
It looked to me like Edler was starting the breakout. It stopped behind his own net. He used it as his ally, and then he was able to jump to the front of the net, and then the pressure from the backside on the back check where there appeared to be a stick infraction from Getzlaff. See if we get a look at it.
You know what? Was he starting to go down already before
tripped
he was
over
hit?
His own, yeah. I think they like to call that the toe pick.
Yeah.
Edler just kind of tripped over his own feet right when Getzlaff put his stick on stick. That's what got the attention of the referee. This Edler going down on his own. So there shouldn't have been a penalty call there.
Well, you know what? I guess in the end it should have been either no call, or if you're going to call something in that case, both guys should get something because neither team deserved to go shorthanded. But it's poor skaters aside. McDonald will chase it down. Pronger moves it along for Solani. It gets through him. Lukas Krajicek now for the Vancouver Canucks. Just over a minute left in this second period. Each team had a goal in the first. Each team with a goal here in the second. They called Getzlaff for the hook. Edler for the unsportsmanlike dive. Now Boschman hands it off. Andy McDonald to the outside against Krajicek. Krajicek able to get a stick on it. Held in by Solani, but his pass didn't go where he wanted it to. And played by Willie Mitchell off the near board. Solani able to win the battle there against Brendan Morris. And now it comes to Naslund in the neutral zone. He's looking for some ice to operate. Waits and hands it off far side on a shot here by Sopel. Deflected over the glass and out of play. Well, how about some news and notes from around these Stanley Cup playoffs. Red Wings and Sharks, that series tied at one. Datsyuk, the late game winner. To tie that series, Senators and Devils, that series tied at one thanks to the overtime game winner by Jamie Langenbrunner. And how about the Rangers? Double overtime, Nylander, the game-winning goal against the Buffalo Sabres to keep the Rangers in that one.
They played a strong game this afternoon, did the Rangers. We expected that kind of performance for them, but because Buffalo's as good as they are, that game went as long as it did.
Yeah. Now Rob Niedermeyer given a push there by Olin. Niedermeyer protecting the puck, hands it off now for his brother Scott. Scott Niedermeyer shot right through. The one not sure where the puck is. Rob Niedermeyer, couple pops at it, finally a whistle.
The ability to get shots through. We talk about Pronger's ability to do it. Scott Niedermeyer able to do it as well. His brother Rob right at the top of the crease. Luongo out to challenge, needs to find that puck. Able to do so, get a good look at it from the overhead. Luongo looking around. He's unsure of where it is. That's almost kind of a feel play.
Yeah.
Try to feel that puck underneath you and kind of watch the reaction of the player that's trying to get at the puck. Niedermeyer had pretty good body position on Olin looking for that second opportunity.
15-6 shot advantage in this period right now for Anaheim. The final 10 seconds. Here is Sean O'Donnell. He sends it to the front of the net. Tipped away by Luongo. Scott Niedermeyer able to hold it in. Gets one more to the net. Sails wide of the glove of Luongo. And so we end the second period as we ended the first in a tie game.
Yeah, well, the score is the same in terms that it's being tied, but Anaheim got themselves back into the hockey game, and it goes to what their assistant coaches were talking about. We weren't that bad in period one. We were just in the penalty box too often. A little bit of a level playing field in period number two, and Anaheim's got themselves right back in it.
The Verizon Wireless Intermission Report is coming up from Hockey Central. Jack Edwards, Keith Jones, Brian Engblom. It's 2-2 here. You're watching the Stanley Cup Playoffs on Versus. Each team still with a man in the box. Remember, Getzlaf and Edler took those coincidental minor penalties. Late in period number two, and we are underway here in this 2-2 game. And trying to get speed to the outside is Bullis. There was some contact there with Boschman. There's going to be a penalty here against Boschman. Olin rolls it across. Lucas Krajicek couldn't handle a bouncing puck. And now on the touch-up here by Boschman, the call is made.
We talked about the importance of owning the neutral zone, speed through center ice, down the wall, and Boschman's forced to get his stick in the midsection. He's going to go to the box.
Let's go down to Billy Jaffe.
Thanks a lot, Dave. You know, that penalty right there was something with Mike Kelly, the assistant coach, talked to me about during the intermission. He says, we just need to keep pushing the puck forward. It's a game of attrition. We've got to tire them out. He thought in the second period that the Canucks' pace kind of dropped off a little bit, perhaps the result of too long of shift length, which you and Andy were talking about. Sometimes, you know, second period, long shift or long change, so that was an issue. On the Anaheim side, Travis Moen in every interview said, let's get the puck deeper. If we do that, we get on the body more, and we get behind. Remember that phrase, Brick? Get behind them. We should be all right.
Get behind and get inside. That's the way Anaheim wants to play.
All over the shot. Tip just by Trevor Linden. The coincidental minors are over, so the short 4-on-3 becomes a 5-on-4. Olin drives the shot. Hit a skate. Linden gets a stick on it. Andrew Sedin couldn't get free, and Getzlaf rims it around and clears it all the way back down behind Luongo. Olin hands it off. Salo dumps it to the near side. Played up the boards by Scott Niedermeyer, and his brother Rob has it here. And behind the play, a penalty. I believe it's going to go against Anaheim for roughing. And there's a who me type look on the face of the Anaheim player, Paulson, who's now going to the box.
Well, Sammy Salo goes cross corner with the dump in with the man advantage and hopes to get this puck back, but Anaheim gets to the puck first, and there's battles along the wall. Sammy Paulson, left side of your screen, he's going to try to get in there. And there's the contact, a little bit from behind, a rough or a board, or whatever you want to call it. He's going to go to the penalty box. We're going to get another look at a 5-on-3. However, this time, a far more extensive 5-on-3 in terms of time on the clock for Vancouver than they had in first period.
Boy, there is no tolerance. That was not much of a hit. But Paulson is in the box, and it's a 5-on-3. Here is Daniel Sedin. Second 5-on-3. And Stronger able to knock Daniel Sedin off the puck. And here is Ryan Getzlaf with it. He'll just send it all the way down the ice. Saddle back to get it. Just under a minute left in this two-man advantage in a 2-2 game in a series that's tied at one. Laguerre plays the puck up the near boards. Naslund gets it to Henrik Sedin. Hands it off now for Saddle. Winds up. Gets it low. Naslund back to Saddle one-timer. Redirected. And that was deflected by Laguerre to the near boards. Henrik Sedin takes a look. Gets the return pass from Trevor Linden. Back to Linden at the goal line. Linden looking out in front. Stick handles, now the one-timer, Sedin. Save made by Laguerre.
So you like to have patience with a 5-on-3. Trevor Linden was looking to make a play, but he held on to the puck perhaps just a little too long. That makes the penalty killing a little bit easier. You want to transfer that puck, if you can, from low to high, goal line to the tops of the circles. But because Linden hangs on to this a little too long, the penalty killers are in good position, and Laguerre, the most important penalty killer, in the best position.
Henrik Sedin talking to his teammates about this faceoff, and it looks like Linden's going to come in and take it against Getzlaf. They want Linden, the right hand, to draw it back, which he does nicely to Olin. Now it goes to Henrik Sedin. Back to Olin. One-timer just wide of the net. Rebound cleared by O'Donnell. Getzlaf hustles over and gets the big clear for Anaheim. Now Henrik Sedin across the red line. Into the zone. Penalty coming. And it's going to be called interference against the Vancouver Canucks out at the blue line.
Yeah, it's going to be Taylor Pyatt. Almost looked like he was unsure of where to go with Sedin carrying the puck through center ice. Get a look at the body contact and the reason why Pyatt's going to be called for interference. Just trying to get out of the way. Gets left very wisely. He's going to help that penalty call along by showing the official, hey, I'm getting contact. I don't have the puck. I'm just trying to stand my ground here in a three-man set at the defensive blue line.
Well, the crowd reacting to the replay and more to the perceived embellishment there by Getzlaff. So it becomes, right now, a four-on-four situation. Till the Paulson penalty ends, and then Anaheim will have a short power play, but they've already shown they don't need the full 2 minutes. Andy McDonald carries it deep, hands it back for Scott Niedermeyer. Toward the net, it was blocked. Talani for McDonald, and a save by Luongo. Solani again. Battling there with Krychek. Puck comes up the board. Paulson out of the box, but here's Morrison sliding it all the way back into the Anaheim zone. And you can see now the power play with a minute 10 remaining. On the penalty to Taylor Pyatt. Salo wraps it around, and Josh Green just let it go. It rolls all the way back down into the Anaheim zone. Jaguar out to get it ahead of the goal line. Leaves it for Scott Niedermeyer. Now it comes to Teemu Selänne. Carries into the zone. Pass across, hit a skate. Getzlaff held it in, but it's knocked away by Burrows. And Conger now back in his own zone. Conger fakes a pass to Penner. Now winds up, shoots it in behind Luongo. Krychek moves it up the glass. Bouncing puck held in by Pronger. Back for Getzlaff. Hands it off now for Solani. Teemu Selänne in the faceoff circle. Getzlaff looking to the front. Penner setting a screen there. Boschman doesn't see a shooting lane. Hands it off for Getzlaff. Knocked away by Smolinski. Back to the line, Boschman. And that's off the skate. Bullis, and he pushes it ahead. And the final seconds. But here comes Getzlaff. Taking it wide, tried to put it in front, hit the side of the net. Luongo was down and out for a moment, but it comes free, and out of the box comes Pyatt. Could be a two-on-one with Bullis. Bullis takes a look across, foot pass for Pyatt, who was behind him. Mitchell holds it in, dumps it back towards Jaguar, and he has it in the glove, and holds on.
The big body of Chris Pronger able to handle this two-on-one with Bullis and Pyatt right out of the penalty box. It's a great penalty killing by the Ducks. Bullis has had a strong game tonight. He forces the turnover at the defensive blue line, and great timing with Pyatt. He tries to use that little aerial pass, but with that big body of Pronger laid prone to the ice with the arms extended, it has to be an aerial pass, but it's well behind Pyatt. Hadn't even really returned to the ice yet, and an opportunity goes by the boards, but a good defensive play by the big defenseman.
Taylor Pyatt, there's going to be another penalty to Anaheim here right off the faceoff. Corey Perry heading to the box.
Free hand wrapped around.
Anaheim, number 10, minor penalty, holding.
Right off the faceoff, Perry trying to get out to that point position, his responsibility. Middle of your screen, Pyatt runs that little bit of interference, a little bit of a screen. He's entitled to that space on the ice. Free hand off the stick. Once it gets off the shaft and it gets up around that shoulder or back area, you're going to go to the box.
Fans are probably wondering, why are we getting these kind of penalties at this stage of the season in the playoffs? But you know what? It's so much more intense now. I think it's a relearning process again for the players. Very little was really done there by Corey Perry. I don't know that he impeded the progress at all of the Vancouver player. But again, the official in the neutral zone sees that hand off the stick, as you mentioned.
Yeah, the players to a man, they have to speak this way. You have to play through it.
A shot to the net is wide of Jaguar. Power play number 8 for Vancouver. Olin sends it deep for Daniel Sedin. Henrik on the far side. Daniel wanted to go quickly to the front to Trevor Linden, who was there. Now it comes to Olin. He gets Trevor Linden. Fans on the one-timer as a sliding Boschman was coming over for the shot block. Henrik Sedin takes a shot. in the back, but fights through that. Olin slides it in wide. Daniel Sedin couldn't control. Paulson, good read. Got over there quickly to the puck and clears.
But you get a pretty good idea of the Sedins and their ability to cycle the puck. Just a slight hesitation and maybe a fumbling of the puck. Sedin did have Linden off that far side.
Getzlaff able to knock it down, but it's recovered by the Canucks. Here's Taylor Pyatt with it. He goes back to the point. Sofer toward the net. Knocked down. Recovered here by Naslin, who has a power play goal tonight for Vancouver in this 2-2 game three. Series is tied at one. Naslin looking out to the line, finds Matthias Olin. Now for Sofer. Winds up, drives a high shot. Tipped to a save by Jaguar. Comes off the end board. Ends up behind the net. Morrison to Olin. Straight away for Sofer. Far side, Naslin. Naslin a shot. And that went wide. Pronger with a steal, wraps it on the far side, hustling over Sofer, able to hold it in. Just under half a minute on the power play, and one-handed by Taylor Pyatt just up over top of the net. And here is Pronger, risking it all the way down the ice.
What a difference a power play goal makes for your mental approach to the man advantage. The late first period goal by Naslin, the improvements on the man advantage by Vancouver, the decision making is sharper, the execution better, all because of that power play goal to get him off the schneid.
Final seconds now in the Corey Perry minor penalty, and he comes out of the box, and Huskins with it now, being pursued by Hansen. Huskins jams it all the way back to center ice. Krajicek in front of the Vancouver bench. Now it comes back, Huskins for DePenta. DePenta hands it off now. Rob Niedermeyer gets it deep. He'll go in on the forecheck against Mitchell. Mitchell moved it quickly. Pass up the middle, didn't connect with Smolinski, but it's off the center ice. DePenta for Corey Perry. Look out as Mitchell stood up on him. And now the flip by Smolinski to center ice. DePenta drives it right back in behind Luongo. And it wraps all the way to the far side of center ice. Anna Kampson trying to make a play on it, but Getzlaff wins the battle. Now Corey Perry up the right side, trying to get in on Mitchell. Perry on the forehand, out between the circles. It's knocked away by Cowan to the far side. Now Burrows with it, just chips it off the wall, and it goes out of play. 12:20 remaining here in the third period. We may have a penalty for delay of game when we come back. We'll see. That is Taylor Pyatt, but he took some advice from Jeff Cowan, who's wearing the microphone, mic'd up, presented by Bud Light.
Hey, boys, keep driving the net, hey, Tyson? Yeah, keep driving, boys, keep driving the net.
Good advice from Coach Cowan. But it is a power play, delay of game against Burrows of Vancouver just as we went to break. And the Ducks have the man advantage. Here's Pronger. Hands it off far side. One-timer. Score! Perry took the shot. Kunitz was screening in front. We'll wait and see who gets the goal. But second power play goal of the night for the Ducks. And they regain the lead.
We'll go back to the Marcus Naslin goal at the end of the first period. That power play goal scored on a similar penalty call. Getzlaff throwing the puck out of play. Burrows does the same, leads to this power play. Face-off win, that's the key. McDonald gets it back to Pronger. He's gonna play a little catch with Corey Perry as they get into their power play set. Two Vancouver Canucks converge on Pronger. Not what you want when you're killing a penalty. That's gonna leave bodies open. And it was Corey Perry that gets the return pass. He's inside the tops of the circles. He's inside the face-off dot. Tee that puck up. It appeared that Luongo got a piece of it with Kunitz right on top of him.
Yep.
I think this will be Perry's goal.
Well, Perry's been in the penalty box a couple of times, so, and really hasn't seen a whole lot of ice time. Didn't see much in the first period because of the shorthanded situation, as Olin is just run over by Kunitz. And the helmet and the stick, everything flying to the ice. The helmet coming off the head of Olin. What a hit by Kunitz.
And the question on the Vancouver bench is, isn't that a high hit? Wasn't that a high hit by Kunitz on Olin?
For the third time in this game, Anaheim has a one-goal advantage at the line. This is held in by O'Donnell. Sends it deep now. Andy McDonald with it. Tried to go up the boards to Pronger, and it's out to center ice. Mike Kunitz, what a hit on Matthias Olin, who is still on the bench, still without his helmet on, and his stick is still lying on the ice. Clearing attempt held in by Pronger here. He goes to Solani. Wanted to shovel it off there for McDonald. Well, on the far side, a one-timer by Solani misfired. The helmet of Olin still there as well. Big hit by Mitchell. Boy, did he just run over Travis Mullen. Travis is a big body himself. And Mitchell with the clear to center ice. Anaheim now 2-for-4 on the power play. Again, the importance of special team. It is Perry's goal from Pronger as Paulson sends this one in wide. Now Boschman slides it along in deep. It hits that stick that's lying there. A steal by Paulson drives a shot. Luongo gave up a rebound, but getting to it is Edler. Hands it off now for Henrik Sedin. Had his pocket picked by Paulson. Say that five times fast. And this is covered up by Luongo.
Well, it's getting physical here late in the hockey game. Willie Mitchell trying to respond to the hit by Chris Kunitz on Matthias Olin. I think that sound alone tells you how big that was. Here's the hit by Kunitz on Olin. Came from a long distance, number one. Finish was a little high. Olin in that tough position with his head kind of down, his body leaning forward. Very prone to be hit and hit hard. No penalty call, certainly not on the Mitchell hit, but not on the Kunitz hit either.
Corey Perry's first goal of this series and second career playoff goal. He had one against the Wild in round one as it comes back to the line. Huskins after the faceoff win by the Ducks. Here's Corey Perry, your goal scorer, in front for Penner, who has one of the other goals. It's been Penner, Boschman, and Perry for Anaheim. Naslin and Daniel Sedin for the Canucks. Olin right back out. Now Getzlaf, Penner and Perry again. A chance here for Perry, just wide on the glove side. And the way Luongo flinched after that puck was past him, I don't think that he saw it leave the stick. Now at the side of the net, covered by Luongo.
Take another look at the goal by Corey Perry. That's the difference in this one right now as the Ducks lead the Canucks 3-2. Talk about getting bodies in front of Luongo. What a great look at Kunitz setting the screen on the goal by Perry.
To the score, Ducks over the Canucks here, and that guy Dustin Penner is having a big influence in the game tonight. He told me just the other day that compared to last year to this year in the playoffs, he's lost that oblivious feeling, meaning last year he was a rookie, just looking to do anything. Now he knows what it takes to be an impact player in the playoffs. And he also said about his line, we're not making nearly as many hope plays. We know what we're doing with the puck now. When we have a purpose with it, we make things happen, and guys, they're making it happen tonight for Anaheim.
And right back out on the ice, Penner, Perry, but a quick change by Randy Carlisle as Naslin now. Over the backhanded center ice, Morrison. Naslin picks up a loose puck. Naslin hands it off for Hanson. Hanson on an angle. Centering pass picked up by Mitchell. Mitchell fans on it. Bumped by Solani, and the puck rolls off the center ice. Naslin right back on the attack. But again, the reach of Pronger knocked it away. Morrison dumps it back into the Anaheim zone. We pass the halfway mark of this third period. And the Anaheim Ducks have the only goal of this third, and that's Corey Perry. Again on the power play from Pronger. O'Donnell trying to shield the puck away from the Vancouver forecheck. Mitchell pinched in from the left point. Now Travis Mullen gets to it and backhands it into the Vancouver zone. Lukas Krajicek back to get it. Series is tied at one, game four here on Tuesday night. Before heading back to Honda Center in Anaheim for game five on Thursday night. Now Paulson for Rob Niedermeyer. He's got Mullen going for the net. Here's a shot in wide. Luongo able to get a blocker on it to send it to the corner. Now Matthias Olin back into his own zone. Hands it off for Sofa. Shots are 22-21 Vancouver. After that big 13-2 advantage that the Canucks had through the first 20 minutes. John Bulis pumped off the puck, gets left for Perry. Perry cutting in, couldn't get a shot off. Luongo has it covered. There's a penalty coming. It's a hooking call that's going to go against Brent Sopel.
Back-to-back turnovers by Vancouver in the neutral zone. Getzlaff forces the second one. What a great presence of mind behind the back pass to set up Corey Perry.
Number four, minor penalty hooking.
And when Perry picks this puck up after the good play by Getzlaff, is the steal. Now Vancouver's in real trouble. Look at this feed. Perry now in alone. All Sopel can do is reach in behind. That's a classic hook. Watch this puck, though. Even though it's fumbled, it was still going towards the direction of the empty net. Luongo had to catch it almost by accident with that back left leg.
Already 2-for-4 with a man advantage and a power play goal here in the third. Ducks go to work again. Here's Pronger. Hands it off far side now. Corey Perry. Checked by Salo. And the puck recovered by Matthias Olin. He sends it all the way down the ice and double checks his stick, which he thought he may have broken, but apparently it's okay. Pronger, Scott Niedermeyer back on the blue line. Andy McDonald, Corey Perry. And Chris Kunitz up front on this power play. And a steal, and back the other way comes Burrows. He's got Josh Green coming with him. Two and now four Anaheim players back. And Burrows will just kill a little time, send it back to Mitchell. Slides it across for Krajicek. Little throw and catch. And now all the way down the ice.
A good job by Vancouver to create that turnover at their defensive blue line, but what appeared to be a two-on-one did not happen. Why? Scott Niedermeyer's ability to skate back and defend.
Scott Niedermeyer hands it off for Corey Perry. A crisp pass across, had too much on it. And back comes Smolinski shorthanded with Jan Bulis. Bulis top of the chip, tried to slide it back in front, and it hit a skate. Or the Canucks may have had a good shorthanded bid there. .635 remaining here in the third period. Ducks with a 3-2 lead. Boschman puts it up on the boards. Round behind Luongo. Mitchell fanned on it. It'll be recovered here by Pronger. Takes a look. Goes to Solani. That was supposed to be a pass. It was blocked. Now Getzlaff has it. Throws it back in deep for Penner. Pushed along the boards by the Canucks. Pronger sends it back for Dustin Penner. Far side now for Getzlaff. Getzlaff with it out to the line. One-timer Pronger. Save made by Luongo. NHL playoffs every night on Versus. Tomorrow, a doubleheader of Game 3s, first at 7 o'clock. It'll be the Devils taking on the Senators. Eastern Conference semis, that series tied at 1. And then the Red Wings and the Sharks hit the ice in the Western semis. That'll be tomorrow at 10 Eastern. And on Tuesday, the Ducks and Canucks go at it again right here from General Motors Place Tuesday night at 10 Eastern. It will be a 2-1 series at that point, but which team will have that advantage? The Ducks have a 3-2 lead in this game. 10 seconds left on the power play. Good play by Henrik Sedin to glove it to a teammate. Now it comes back to center ice, and a bouncing puck just chipped away by Ponder. Out of the box comes Sopel. Angle Sedin across the line. Sends it in deep. Jaguar. For Pronger. Far side, Travis Mohn. They get it now to Henrik Sedin for Daniel, along with Taylor Pyatt out here now. With 5.5 remaining in the third, and the Canucks needing a goal to tie this thing up. Pyatt takes it along the end board. Hands it off for Matthias Olin. Boschman stepped into him. Now Henrik Sedin lost it to Paulson, who plays it around on the far side. Lukas Krajicek is there for the Canucks. Taylor Pyatt leaves it for Daniel Sedin. He couldn't get through. And Boschman calmly pokes it to Pronger. Nice outlet pass off the skate of Mohn, and it's set back the other way, and a quick offside call. 5:02 remaining in regulation. Don't go away. Just one goal separates the Ducks and the Canucks. Numbers.
The NHL Stanley Cup Playoffs on Versus is brought to you by Esurance. Make it your goal to save on auto insurance. Visit Esurance.com today.
Well, part of the in-arena entertainment here at General Motors Place. They're waving the white towels, trying to encourage the home team, the Trails, by a score of 3-2 here in Game 3 of this Western Conference semifinal series. Quick change by Anaheim. Randy Carlisle gets five different players out on the ice now with the Sedin line out here for Alain Vigneault. As it comes down to Daniel Sedin. Back for Henrik. Looking for Taylor Pyatt. Now the puck is recovered by Daniel Sedin. Pyatt along the end boards. Given a rough ride to the boards by Paulson. Got it to the line and just out. And it was going to be a delayed call. Now they'll make the offside call.
Great matchups here. The chess game continues, particularly late in the hockey game. The Ducks trying to protect this one goal lead. What do you want? You want the Paulson line against the Sedin twins line. How about this play by Sammy Paulson? Takes Hyatt and Daniel Sedin out of the play with body contact in the defensive zone. Leads to a turnover, leads to puck possession for Anaheim. They're able to clear their own end.
Career playoff numbers of Sammy Paulson, and don't be fooled by low offensive numbers. This guy's value is in so many other areas. Many think he's a front runner for the Selke Award as the best defensive forward.
You can make numbers say a lot of different things, and your eyes tell you that Sammy Paulson is critical to the success of Anaheim in all those areas.
Now here comes Solani trying to backhand it out in front, hit the skate of Mitchell. The two of them battle. Now Marcus Naslund, the captain of this Vancouver team, who has one of the goals tonight. Morrison on a deflected puck. Now it's knocked away by Pronger. Morrison knocked down by Andy McDonald. As we wind down towards 4 minutes, straight up left here in regulation. Stripped away from Hanson, and Kunitz will flip it back in wide of Luongo. And again, very short shifts. Both coaches trying to make sure that everybody's fresh.
And that red line becomes critical. If you're protecting that lead, you got to get the line. If you don't have numbers, make sure that puck gets all the way deep into Vancouver zone. And conversely, Vancouver's got to get that red line and lay the pucks in areas where they can get it back offensively if Anaheim's standing up in center ice.
Now the Canucks didn't get it deep on that rush, and now it's back in deep in their own zone. Sokol around for Trevor Linden. And Linden hands it off for Olin, right wing side. Now Bulis, it comes back to the middle of the ice. Puck is recovered here by Sokol, hands it off on the far side. Malinsky wanted to hit Olin, now it comes to the front of the net. Dustin Penner able to get to it, protecting the puck. Lays it up the board. Sokol is there. Deflects it to the corner. Now Smolinski goes back to Sokol. His shot knocked down. Linden fanned on it right in the high slot. And back the other way come the Anaheim Ducks as Huskins, the defenseman, does get it deep and allows for the change.
Nice try by Brian Smolinski. He got knocked down hard on the back check by Getzlaff, but he got back up into the play and nearly made a good pass from circle to circle.
Got Niedermeyer, blocked an outlet pass. Here's Travis Mullen. That's off the stick of Krychek. Now it comes to Pyatt with 2.5 remaining here in regulation. Ducks with a 3-2 lead, trying to get home ice advantage back by winning a road game here.
And this Paulson again on the back check, yep. Not letting Vancouver get to center ice.
Henrik Sedin, a little backhand flip. It was deflected. It's a delayed offside. Now they'll call it right away. 2:15 remaining here in Vancouver in our Stanley Cup playoff coverage. Professional bull riding, the Nampa Classic from Nampa, Idaho, is coming up next here on Versus. Sometimes for the Sedins and this Vancouver team, it must feel like a bull riding competition when you're going against Pronger and Scott Niedermeyer and Boschman. One of those three guys out there virtually the entire game. And again, the Ducks preventing Vancouver from getting it deep. Now the puck is flipped over the glass and out of play. And we've got a couple of minutes here. I said at one point we're 4 minutes remaining, and now we're down to 2 minutes, and Vancouver hasn't been able to get the puck in deep.
Yeah, and give credit to Anaheim and the way they are protecting this lead. They're getting it on the forecheck with one forechecker and really pinching down the neutral zone. They've owned the center ice area, not allowed Vancouver any opportunity to get across that red line. When things have happened in the defensive zone where they've had opportunities, your gear's been strong.
Sokol, center ice, knocked away by Boschman, who came up. And again, Randy Carlisle making very quick changes. A 1-2-2 setup for Anaheim in the neutral zone. Here's Henrik Sedin, gets it into the zone, but again, it's picked up before it got to the tops of the circle. Sent back the other way. Now an icing call, finally. We're going to be down with a faceoff deep in the Anaheim zone. And the question for Alain Vigneault, a minute 39, Brick, does he take Luongo out now because it's been so difficult to get a puck deep in the Anaheim zone.
Yeah, and I'm of the philosophy I get him out right now. I'm not sure that he will opt to do that, but because of that reason, that's what I'm looking to do. But certain coaches go by certain time codes in terms of what do the numbers show you when you score with the goaltender pull.
Faceoff win by Anaheim. Niedermeyer played it up the boards. Olin got a stick on it. Matias Olin unable to hold it in. And now Luongo starting to edge out to the top of the crease, looking over to the bench. Here's Naslin with it now. There goes Luongo to the bench. Naslin right through. Saved by Shakir on the rebound, sent just wide. And now the Ducks able to clear it back the other way. This isn't going to be icing. The puck's not going to get close to the goal line. Olin wraps it around for Salo. Still over a minute remaining. A steal. Lane of it down and up and net. Hit the goalpost. He hit it flush off the goalpost. Now can Vancouver take advantage of that bit of luck?
It was a great play by Boschman along the boards defensively in his own zone. Body contact and cleared his end.
Now it comes center ice to Naslin. Backhands it in deep. Six attackers out there for Vancouver. Up the board, Boschman couldn't get it through. Another effort, pinching in with Sopel. Now here's Boschman, kind of failed to clear. He panned on it as Sopel sends it in deep. Morrison along the end boards, taken away by Boschman. Now Naslin out to the line. Sopel toward the traffic, knocked down by Boschman. Loose puck and it bounces towards Jaguar. Now it comes free. Boschman hit hard. Naslin, the puck underneath the fallen Anaheim defenseman. He gloves it out of there. Taken by Morrison. Hands it off for a shot by Pyatt that was stopped. A dozen seconds remaining. Krychek through traffic. Loose puck. Here's Naslin. Stopped by Jaguar. And Pyatt is pile driven as Jaguar has it covered.
With well over a minute to go in regulation, protecting a one-goal lead, Randy Kyle opts to have the McDonald Kunitz Solani line on the ice. McDonald nearly ended this game with the open net. After Vancouver could not control the puck along the wing boards, McDonald's going to scoop a puck up, and he's going to curl right inside the circle. His wrist shot beats Olin, but it hits the post. And now the play comes up ice, and they've had to rely on Shakir. The desperation, the hunting down of pucks, the opportunities for Vancouver, whether it's in a scrum or shot from the side. Jaguar did a terrific job to locate pucks, stay in position, stay in control of himself. Wow, what action.
You can tell that Don Koharski is checking. They want to make sure that the 5.8 seconds that shows on the clock is the correct time.
He's signaling that it is.
And a faceoff to the left of Jaguar. Huge faceoff here. Paulson for Anaheim. Trevor Linden wins it for Vancouver. It comes out to Olin. And the shot was blocked from the boards right in front. And it was stopped by Jaguar as the horn goes and the green light comes on. The Anaheim Ducks, after losing on home ice, win on the road here in game three to grab a 2-1 lead in the series.
Well, what this tells you is 5.8 seconds is a heck of a long time. Paulson in the faceoff with Linden. Linden does a great job to win it to the near boards. Moan gets right out, does what he's supposed to do. In the shooting lane, blocks the initial shot, but then the follow-up finds Sedin off that far post, the overhead with time ticking down. The blocker stopped by Jaguar. Sedin's last-ditch effort, the push-off by Jaguar. He never loses sight of the puck. He's in control. He doesn't want another puck sneaking by his short side.
And that was the same skate and the same side. That, of course, the one did sneak through in game two. But it is a 3-2 final. And yes, some fans here from Southern California making the trip to Vancouver. But the Ducks now lead this series 2-1. So for Andy Brickley, Billy Jaffe at ice level, and our entire Versus crew, I'm Dave Strader. Thanks for joining us. Stay with us here on Versus as we go now to professional bull riding in Nampa, Idaho. Again, the final score here in Vancouver, 3-2 Ducks over the Canucks to grab a 2-1 lead in the series.